I'm going to turn this over to Clete to talk about the national security issues as you see them. And Clete, we've focused primarily on China, but could you also say a few words on how you see this playing out with Russia and also with non-adversaries that nevertheless collect data in ways that some people consider to be very threatening? And since it's election season, I'll just mention Cambridge Analytica, again, a British company, not on the list, not in the crosshairs, but one that, you know, many people were very, thought were, you know, was a very threatening to US election security and therefore national security. So over to you.
Sure, thank you. And Adam, I enjoyed your presentation very much. I apologize, I don't have a really nice visual for everyone. But I thought Adam did a good job of laying out sort of all the different facets of this and what some of the concerns are, you know, that have been articulated by this administration. And again, I think would be articulated by a subsequent administration. So we'll just call it, you know, the concerns articulated by the U.S. government. You know, when and I don't want to get too caught up in the semantics of what's national security and what's data security. I mean, I think the bottom line is, you know, we can sit here and argue about sort of what the right tools are or what the right thing to call it is, but our government does perceive a threat that's manifest in a couple of different ways. And I was struck on Friday, and some of the journalists on here might have gotten some of the same briefings as I did from our government, but they really focused, I think, on three issues when they talked about why they needed to do what they were doing. With TikTok and WeChat, and this is in terms of the IEPA order, and also, you know, sort of explained why it was unique to China. So let me touch on that for a minute. I mean, the three things that they really focused on are data collection, which, again, I know is the subject of this, but I would posit is sort of, in some ways, not the preeminent national security concern, although it is a concern. And, you know, one of the reasons that they articulated the data collection as being a concern was this notion of blackmail, something used by intelligence services around the world. You get sensitive information about people, whether it's health information, whether, you know, whatever, you know, financial information, and then you use it to develop sources. And I do think that that's an element of data collection that's undervalued in this discussion. I also think there's the issue of artificial intelligence. And simply the competition between the U.S. and China to be better at artificial intelligence, so we're better at military stuff, and that if China's companies are collecting more data than ours, we're at a disadvantage. So there's sort of a national security element there. It's a very broad one. I mean, it really applies to almost any Chinese company, including those that the U.S. thinks have linkages to the government, to the military, which they do think here. So there's the data collection, again, just one part of it. The other part of it, Adam also touched on this in a couple of different ways, is, you know, espionage and surveillance. And one of the things the government was talking about, in particular with WeChat, was the surveillance of Chinese, you know, formerly Chinese citizens who are now in the United States. And I think one of the things they mentioned in their August 6th executive order is that they had uncovered a database in China of all the WeChat messages for all Chinese citizens living abroad. So you have some real surveillance issues here that they're worried about, you know, in addition to the ability to put backdoors into a lot of the stuff, including into the source code. And then the third one that the government has focused on is propaganda. And, you know, both propaganda in terms of through the TikTok interface, or WeChat's social media interface, sort of pushing out, you know, different viewpoints that they want to be heard by American citizens. And Russia, you know, does this as well as China, I mean, potentially divisive, you know, trying to cause division in our society. But then there's the question of censorship. And are these Chinese platforms promoting a view of the world or censoring a view of the world that's different than what the Communist Party wants people to see? And that is a real concern here for the US government. And they talked about all three of those things. Now, they apply to China, I think, in a special way. And this sort of gets to the question, I'm gonna touch on Europe for a second. I know in sort of the lead up to this event, there was some discussion of like, how is Europe's approach different than the issue? How is Europe's approach to US companies different than the U.S. concerns about Chinese companies. And I would say there's a couple big reasons, but let me give you three very clear ones. You know, the first one is the track record that these Chinese companies have. I mentioned one example on WeChat. There's lots of other examples where Chinese companies actually have been caught doing things like this. Number two, there's the national intelligence law, which I think is very important in terms of just giving the Chinese government the ability to have Chinese companies essentially do whatever they need in accordance with their national security interests. And quite frankly, we don't have anything quite like that in the United States. And, you know, when you hear from Europe saying we're concerned about U.S. spying, right, because that's some of the justification that they give, it's not that U.S. companies are collecting data on behalf of the U.S. government. It's a very different situation. And so there's that national intelligence law and the fact that we believe that Chinese companies will act at the behest of their government whenever asked. And that is a key distinction between them. And then the third one is just the whole nature of the Chinese government itself. You know, the fact that it is not a democracy. They don't have free speech in the same way. And so there is this concern that these companies are both linked to the government and that they will utilize or they will use propaganda and censorship to further their aims. So again, there's a very different ways to look at it. I will say though, the US is also very concerned about what's going on in Europe. And we can get into this as well if we have time. And you know, you have a situation where Europe is also looking at restricting US companies right now. But the way I've always understood it is not that they're worried about Google or Facebook or whomever, you know, sort of spying and, you know, on behalf of the US government, but rather there's sort of the individualized privacy right. But then there's also this question of the value of the data. And do these companies gain some value by having all of this data? And why shouldn't Europe share in that value? That seems to be the sentiment. Now, from a US lens, we are very worried that it sounds like industrial policy protectionism and the fact that we've got these great big tech companies in the US, Europe doesn't have them, and we need to extract some money from them so we can build our own national competitors. And when you look at what Europe is doing on data and digital sovereignty, from a US government perspective, it looks a little bit like it is an attempt to build a competitive EU, a set of competitors within the EU. So again, I look at that as more of an economic issue, a personalized privacy issue, and not the same type of national security issue that you see going back and forth between the US and China. I don't want to go on too long. We can get into all these issues. I just want to comment on one thing that Adam said sort of about the Chinese response. You know, my view overall is that we are going to have, you know, I'm going to use the word relative, relative calm between now and election day. I think that, you know, from China's perspective, people can argue whether this is right or wrong. But I believe the U.S. intelligence agencies, when they say they think China would like to see Joe Biden elected as president to bring some more predictability to the situation, and they do believe that they will get a better shake from him than they've gotten from President Trump. People can argue whether that's right or wrong. That's what our intelligence community has said. I do think that's right. And I do think, therefore, China is going to resist from really casting the die on the strongest actions against U.S. companies because they want to see if they can reverse this thing in a couple months. But the unreliable entities framework did come out over the weekend, which was a clear response to what the U.S. is doing here. And I would just say as a final comment, you know, I also find it a little bit ironic to talk about Chinese retaliation at all, because as we'll recall, how many U.S. companies like this? If the U.S. had started TikTok, it wouldn't have been allowed in China in the first place. There wouldn't have been a need to ban it because they never would have allowed it to operate. And you look at Twitter, you look at Google, all these companies are out of the Chinese market because they won't censor and therefore they're not allowed in the market. So I just, you know, the notion of retaliation, I think in some sense is a misnomer. China's already closed its market down to these kinds of companies from the U.S. And again, they may take some actions pursuant to the unreliable entities list, but I think it'll be pretty muted between now and November.